So maybe I will start from a very well-known theorem by Gromov, filling gradius inequality. So this theorem answers the following question. So assume that we have some manifold, and we would like to embed it somewhere in some ambient space isometrically, where isometrically means in this talk is that distances in the inner metric are equal to the distances in the outer metric. So we would like to embed it somewhere, and then we would like to fill it by chain. And our question somehow, we would like to fill it by some kind of chain so that this chain would be as close as possible to our manifold MN, obviously in the metric of the ambient space. Now, one well-known and nice way to embed a manifold isometrically somewhere is a well-known Kuratovsky embedding that sends each point to the distance function from this point, right? And so, for example, one could study filling in this space, but also Gromov figured it out that, in fact, if we really would like to make the radius of this neighborhood as small as possible, then actually L infinity of M and this Kuratovsky embedding is the best way to embed. And when one embeds into L infinity, it turns out that this filling radius doesn't exceed some constant that can be explicitly written down to the volume of M of M to the power 1 over N, so that those quantities scale the same. Okay, so why is this of any interest? So here is one very interesting application. One could regard it even as an application to geometric calculus of variation. So let's consider a class of essential manifolds. These are manifolds that exhibit a certain interaction between their fundamental groups and homology groups. This class includes all spherical manifolds, which includes all two-dimensional surfaces, projective spaces, RPN, I mean, and many other spaces. The formal definition, if you care, is that given a manifold, there is something that's called classifying map, which consists essentially in killing all one by one higher dimensional homotopy group of M and adding extra cells. And we look at the induced homomorphism in homology. And the condition is that the homology class, the fundamental homology class, is sent to something non-trivial in homology of pi 1 of Mn. Or speaking perhaps more simply, that the map, the induced homomorphism of the nth homology groups is non-trivial. So, all right, so why do I care about those essential manifolds? So it turns out, and it's kind of very easy to prove, that if we have an essential manifold, then the length of the shortest non-contractible closed curve, which of course happens also to be a geodesic, a periodic geodesic, and hopefully we all care about periodic geodesics, doesn't exceed 6 times filling radius of the manifold. And combined with the previous inequality, we get a upper bound for the shortest periodic geodesic, even non-contractible geodesic, purely in terms of the volume. So the proof of this theorem is actually proven very easily. So maybe I will just draw briefly a proof of this theorem. So it proves works like that. It's the impossible extension argument, modern versions of which appeared yesterday in the talk by Stefan and several days ago in the talk by Irina. So it works like that. Given some n, we have this Wn plus 1, and we know that there is no retraction of Wn plus 1 to Mn, right, because of the essentiality. And we would like to, not because of the essentiality. So let's do this proof in the following case. I'm going to do this proof in a specific case when my manifold is a spherical. So assume, for example, that my manifold is a spherical. I know that there is no retraction of this chain to Mn. And nevertheless, I will try to construct an impossible retraction. I am going to triangulate both M and WN, and I will try to extend identity map of MN to the whole WN plus 1. Right, I know that it's impossible, but still I will try. And I will assume the proof will be by contradiction. I will be aided by the assumption that each closed curve of length at most 6 filling radius is contractible. So how will it go? I will start, first of all, I will map vertices of the triangulation of WN plus 1 to the nearest points in MN. So here all vertices are very close, but after I will map them to WN plus 1, because of the triangle inequality, I can be sure that the distances will be less than the filling radius plus epsilon. Now I map one-dimensional simplices to the shortest geodesics of this length. Now I need to extend to two simplices. Now the boundary of each two simplex has length bounded by 6 filling radius plus something small, but I am assuming that all such curves are contractible MN, so I will contract them. So far, I extended everything to the two skeleton, but since MN was assumed to be a spherical, the further extension will be automatic. The further abstraction groups will be living in a high-dimensional homotopy groups of MN, which were all assumed to be trivial. So that's the proof of this theorem, which immediately gives a very nice application of this inequality for the filling radius. So let's go for, so the proof by Gromov of his inequality relating the filling radius and the volume, it had some predecessors, Federer and Fleming, Michael and Leon Simon, as well as some followers. Stefan Wenger, that kind of simplified and streamlined proof of Gromov, and Larry Goose. So Larry Goose, in particular, observed two important advances, each of which solved a conjecture by Gromov. So in order to explain what did he do, let us make the following observation. So when we have this inequality, filling radius of MN is at most some constant volume to the power 1 over n mn. Let's interpret it like that. Assume that we would like to make filling radius of m to be less than or equal to 1. So if we would like to ensure that the filling radius is at most 1, it's sufficient to demand that volume will be less than some constant. If volume is sufficiently small, filling radius will be less or equal than 1. So the first observation of Larry Goose, I mean, it's not observation, it's a different proof of Gromov's theorem that yielded this improvement, is that if we really would like to get this filling radius of MN less or equal than 1, we don't need to assume that the whole volume is small. It's sufficient only to assume that the volume of each metric ball of radius 1 is small. So the second improvement by Larry was the following. If we are going to assume this, if we are going to make this less this weaker conjecture hypothesis that all balls of radius 1 have small volume, we actually can get more. We are going to get not only the upper bound for this filling radius, but an upper bound for so-called Urosson widths of our manifold. I will explain in a second which is kind of up to a constant is greater than the filling radius. It could be a stronger inequality. So let me explain what is this Urosson widths. If we have our Riemannian manifold, which for us is just some kind of nice metric space, or more generally any compact or even non-compact metric space X, right? We could ask ourselves, how close is it to being n minus one dimensional complex, or k dimensional complex? How do we measure it? We are looking at all possible n minus one dimensional complexes. All possible continuous maps. And we try to arrange, to choose this complex and this map to be so that if we are going to take all points in this K, and we are going to take all points of the inverse image, so this will be some sets sitting in X, And if we will calculate diameter of each of those sets, we really would like those diameters to be small. If they are small, then we kind of feel that x is close to k. So I will try to find the smallest, the infimal d, such that there will be some k and some f, so that diameters of all points in the inverse image will be less than this d. So that's the Urson width. So now, right, here is the end of the definition. So what Larry proved is that the volumes of all balls of radius 1 in some n-dimensional Riemannian manifolds are sufficiently small, less than some constant that depend only on the dimension, then Urson width doesn't exceed 1. So here is the theorem. There exists some positive epsilon depending on the dimension with the following property. If each closed metric ball of radius 1 in some given closed Riemannian manifold has small volume, less than this epsilon of n, then the Urson width, n minus 1 width, is less than or equal to 1, meaning that we can map x to some n minus 1 dimensional complex so that all inverse images of points are all have diameter less than 1. So at the end of, so Larry Goose wrote two papers about this. One papers in annals that kind of passed from volumes to volumes of balls. The second that passed from filling radius to Urson width. And at the end of the second paper, he opposed two problems. So one problem which at some early paper he also kind of semi-attributes to Gromov is the following. So is this result holds true for compact n-dimensional metric space with n-dimensional Hausdorff measure? So can we extend it from Riemannian manifolds to just any n-dimensional compact metric space? Of course, we need to consider instead of the volume, we need to consider Hausdorff measure, which will be the same from in the case of the manifolds. So the second question or conjecture that is even stronger will require the following definition. So I'm going now to introduce definition. And it would involve the definition of Hausdorff content. So what is m-dimensional Hausdorff content? So assume that we have, say, compact metric space X, and we cover it by balls. Of radius Ri. And we perform the summation of m's powers of radii. If we wish, we can normalize, but maybe not. And now we would like to take the infimum over all coverings. So observe two things. So unlike Hausdorff measure, we don't insist on radii of those balls being small. They could be arbitrary. So in particular, it's kind of immediately clear that this Hausdorff content will be always less than the m-dimensional Hausdorff measure when it's defined. We are taking the infimum over a much larger set. Also observe that if X is compact, then this infimum will be always achieved. In fact, we could just cover X by just one ball, right? So we'll get some upper bound for the Hausdorff content in that way. So here, M has nothing to do with the dimension of X. So a kind of main point that we could consider M that is less the dimension of X. But even if, for example, X is a Riemannian manifold and M is equal to its dimension, Hausdorff content is something different. So let's imagine, for example, a unit ball with a metric of very large negative curvature. If we have a constant, very large negative curvature, then the volume of this ball will be huge. And Hausdorff measure will be huge, yet we can cover this set by one ball of radius 1. So Hausdorff content is clearly much smaller. Now observe that in principle, we don't need to take radius to the power 2. We could cover by some balls and take and sum the first powers of radii. What we are going to do, for example, if we, for example, this m is equal to 1, we have something akin to the diameter. It's easy to see that in this case we are also going to get 1, but just because the diameter of this set is equal to 2. Okay, so let's go further. Now, after all those preliminaries, so this is the definition of the Hausdorff content. So here is the second problem posed by Larry Goose. Is it true that there exists epsilon m with the following property? Let X be a compact metric space such that the m-dimensional Hausdorff content of each metric ball of radius 1 is less than epsilon m. So observe that this assumption already in the case when we are talking about m-dimensional manifolds is weaker than the assumption that just the volume of balls is less than 1. Now, the conclusion should be the same, that the Urson width of m minus 1 of x is less or equal than 1. There are two main points in this conjecture or question. First point, that we are not talking now about manifolds, but about metric spaces. Second point, that m must be much smaller than the dimension. So the main result, I will explain in a second why it's interesting, but let me just say what will be the main result of the talk. The main result of the talk is the outcome of a joint project with Evgeny Lyakumovich, Boris Lyshak, and Regina Rotman. And basically the main theorem that yes, this conjecture is correct, that's true. So there exists a positive epsilon with the following property. Let X be a compact or even boundedly compact, meaning that all closed metric balls are compact. And assume that for some positive r, earlier I was writing 1, but just it's merely matter of scaling. For some positive r, HCM of B, this M Hausdorff content, is less than epsilon m to the power rm for each metric ball of radius r, then the m minus 1 dimensional Urson width will be at most r. So a couple of words about motivations. Oh, by the way, oh, here is the corollary. So this result has immediate corollary. If you don't care about measuring Hausdorff contents of balls of radius 1, but instead just prefer to measure the Hausdorff content of the whole manifold, we are going to get the inequality that resembles Gromov-Goose inequality only with Hausdorff content instead of volume. And of course, it will be true in the situation when X is a metric space and M has nothing to do with its dimension. So what are motivations? First motivation. So even for Riemannian manifolds, this gives an intrinsic metric criterion when an n-dimensional closed or complete non-compact manifold is closed not merely in n minus 1 dimensional complex, as in Larry's-Goose theorem. So Larry's-Goose result could be regarded as some metric criterion. Assume that we have n-dimensional manifold and we would like to know whether or not it's almost collapsed in certain sense, in this sense, when it's kind of close to something n minus 1 dimensional. According to Larry-Goose theorem, well, it's sufficient to measure volumes of all balls of radius, which is kind of the distance we care about. And if all of them are very small, then yes, our manifold will be close to something lower dimensional. But assume, for example, we would like to know when an MN dimensional manifold is close, for example, to a three-dimensional complex or n minus five-dimensional complex. So then we are going to get a kind of metric criterion in terms of those Hausdorff contents. Second motivation, so for second motivation, observe that Larry Goose also mentions it. So observe that if m-dimensional Hausdorff measure of x is zero, then of course Hausdorff content is equal to zero. Now, the corollary implies that the Urson width is equal to zero. So we see that if we have a compact metric space and its m-dimensional Hausdorff measure is zero, then it's covering a topological dimension that most m minus 1. This is so-called Spielrein theorem, proven in 1930s, at the end of 1930s. So this kind of shows that what we are doing is some kind of Ulam style quantitative version, kind of stability version of this Spielrein theorem. And that's also a point of view by Gus, and he also attributes it to some conversation with Gromov. So, and finally, even if M happens to be the dimension of the manifold, still our result will be a little bit better than the original Filling inequality, because Hausdorff content, as I mentioned, is never more than the volume and could be significantly less. There'll be some improvement. So here are three motivations. Maybe if time permits, I will talk about more. But so what I'm going to do now? Now I'm going to explain why the Gromov's inequality relating Filling radius and volume is correct. I'm going to sketch very briefly its proof. So before sketching its proof, I'm going somehow to present some kind of pseudo proof, why it might look like something which is kind of trivial. So our Mn sits in L infinity of Mn, which is a Banach space. So let's pretend it's just high dimensional Euclidean space. And fill Mn by some kind of minimal surface, possibly singular, but we don't care. And apply the isoperimetric inequality. It will tell us that the volume of this surface will be bounded by n plus 1 over n power of the volume of the manifold times some constant. And this isoperimetric inequality had two versions, a kind of earlier version due to Federer and Fleming had C depending on the dimension of the ambient space. But then there was a later version due to Michel and Leon Simon, where C depends just on the dimension of the manifold. And once we know that, if we are inclined to believe that, then the monotonicity formula would imply that the distance, where do I have Wn plus 1? Here I have Wn plus 1. So it would imply that it will start at some point of Wn plus 1 and we'll be looking at bigger and bigger balls because of the Euclidean growth of the volume. We will need to hit the boundary sufficiently soon. So the Filling radius really cannot be more than volume to the power 1 over n plus 1. So that's a pseudo proof. Now a kind of a sketch of kind of more honest proof, which is Stefan Wenger's version of original Gromov's proof. It's based on two results, area inequality and cone inequality. So maybe I will area inequality and the cone inequality. Maybe later I will talk about what is K-area inequality. Cone inequality is essentially, maybe I will say a couple of words about the cone inequality, just in case. So cone inequality basically is the following idea. We have a something that sits inside a ball of radius R in some ambient Banach space, Euclidean space, Banach space, doesn't matter. And we really would like to fill this hole. And we could do it just by taking any point here or center of the ball and connecting this by a cone. And it's possible to prove that the volume of this cone will be bounded by a constant, which is in the case of the Euclidean space is 1 over its dimension plus 1, times this radius. Times the volume of the base. There are, however, some tricky version of the cone inequality. When we had first some crummy map from something crummy to our ball, and we need to replace this crummy map by some map to the cone, this could be somewhat more difficult to arrange, but basically the idea is the same. Right, so the proof by Wenger is the induction with respect to N. The base of induction corresponds to filling of one-dimensional manifolds, filling of closed curves, and is done easily by coning. Now, in order to explain what's going on further, let me draw the following picture. So assume that here is our manifold, Mn, and we would like it to fill it by something of volume. We are striving for volume to be less or equal than volume of mn up to some constant to the power n plus 1 over n. So if it so happens that mn is round, that its diameter in the ambient Banach space is of the order of magnitude of volume to 1 of the power n, then we are fine. We are just decoding. So our problem when mn is not round, and then somehow intuitively it has thin fingers, and the idea is in improving m by cutting thin fingers. So how does it practically work? So practically, we start at some point, right? And we are looking at intersection of balls in the ambient, Euclidean, in the ambient Euclidean Banach space with our manifold. And initially, the growth of the volume of the intersection is kind of Euclidean with respect to R. And we increase the ball. If it's kind of Euclidean with respect to R, we are in a fine shape. Our manifold is round, and we end up with the column. But if it needs improvement, if it has thin fingers, so sooner or later, the Euclidean growth starts petering off. And we kind of stop, we kind of choose the maximal ball so that the volume of the intersection is Euclidean, but not quite Euclidean. There is some kind of constant in the denominator. This constant is not an honest constant. I am cheating here. So one needs to have more constants. This 1,000 here is given just to convey some idea. So here I take the maximal, or almost maximal ball, maybe this ball, and I'm looking at the part of the manifold inside. It is going to have comparatively big volume, but if I'll continue, the volume will start dropping. And then I'm using area formula in order to find here, yes, and a cut, a sphere of sufficiently small volume that maybe looks like that. And then I'm going to use the induction assumption. I would like to cut this finger and to fill it using the induction assumption by some kind of surface which satisfies the isoperimetric inequality in dimension one less. And one could see that in particular because of this small constant, I gain in volume by some constant factor. And of course, I don't do it just one point. I consider a covering of significant part of my manifold by these thin fingers. Maybe half of the manifold will be covered by thin fingers. And then I'm kind of going to find spheres of small volume nearby. And I'm going to do kind of cut and fill. And by doing that, I am going to improve by a constant volume of significant part of our manifold. And as a result, after this cutting ground, I am going to get a new manifold. So first of all, parts where I didn't touch it, then newly inserted parts, right? And this new manifold is going to have a volume which is kind of constant factor less than the original volume, where the constant is less than 1. Now, it's possible somehow to project those filling chains to those balls. So all this gap between the old manifold and new manifold will lie entirely within those balls. And I can just cone this gap off. So there is some kind of film between old version of my manifold and new version of my manifold. And now I have new manifold, and I could just repeat this procedure. And I will keep improving and improving, and volume keep dropping and dropping until it become very small. When it's very small, I just cone it off. So that's a proof by Wenger. Now I am going to explain what exactly Guth did. So the strategy of the first paper of Guth is the following. So what Guth did, he developed a different proof of Gromov's inequality, which is not like this proof at all. So his proof starts from finding a good covering of manifold by small balls. If time permits, I will explain at the end of the talk how exactly one covers MN by those balls. I'm not going to do it right now. But the general strategy afterwards will be to map this manifold to the nerve of this covering, which will be metric nerve. It will come with certain metric. So what's rectangular nerve? I'm not going to explain. Basically, I mean, it's some version of the standard concept of nerve where what you get are just simplices. Here, what you get are parallelepipeds. So essentially, I mean, I can maybe just say a couple of words. So essentially, each ball of the covering corresponds to a coordinate of the space where you're sending your manifold. So one has, just in order for this not to look so mysterious, because it's very simple, let me explain. So if one has a ball of radius, say Ri, one introduces a function which is equal to zero outside. It is equal to Ri, so that's some function phi on our manifold, to R. It will be equal to Ri up to half of the radius. And here it will just drop linearly from Ri to zero. So its function clearly has a kind of small Lipschitz constant. And one has those functions for all balls. And then just one sends, one uses those functions as coordinates. And one sends the manifold to some kind of parallelepiped with sides equal to the radius of the ball of the covering. And so the Lipschitz constant of the map is controlled, easily controlled. And so if my manifold, or some ball in my manifold, had small volume, then the image inside each face still will have small volume. And now third stage. Third stage consists in the following. We are again improving our manifold inside each face. This time, each face is just the Euclidean space. Our nerve will be just some kind of parallelepiped in high dimensional Euclidean space. So we could just find, somehow, we are looking first of all at the manifold inside the maximal face, face of the maximal dimension. We are kind of improving our manifold face by face, starting from the face of maximal dimension. So here we have something of very small volume sitting inside the face, maybe something like that. And we're just improving it by replacing this part by the minimal surface that has exactly the same boundary. And the idea is that because of the monotonicity formula, this minimal surface, because the volume is very small, because of the monotonicity, this minimal surface will sit very closely to the boundary of the face. And then one could just do some kind of central projection to the boundary of this face. And this projection is going to have very small Lipschitz constant. If we are very close to the boundary, this Lipschitz constant will be close to one. So now we could repeat, rinse and repeat. So we find ourselves in some face, replaced by minimal surface, project. And we are doing that until we will reach dimension n minus one. Because of the small measure, still there will be a lot of space in n-dimensional faces to push everything down to dimension n minus one. And then there is a not very difficult argument. So essentially, we are replacing cycles in the nerve by homologous cycles. And eventually, we end up with the zero cycle. And there is an argument that to all this filling, we are going to get a filling of small radius under the Nabutovsky embedding. It turns out to be actually quite easy. Right, so maybe I'll just skip this. Now, what Larry Goose did in the second paper. So what is a drawback of this improvement process? The drawback here is that we have a manifold that is being mapped to this nerve, but we don't modify this map phi. Instead, we are modifying the image without really keeping our map. So in his second paper, he decided to modify the map. I will explain in a second why it's better to modify the map. So how did he modify it? So when one finds oneself inside some face, instead of just merely inserting minimal surface with the same boundary, essentially he just mimicked the Wenger's proof of Gromov's theorem. So it was exactly the same kind of extension with trying to cover by balls, looking at the moment when the Euclidean growth starts peter out, using query formula somehow to find a good cut, using the induction assumption for a good filling, repeating it recursively. It was essentially the same proof, only now we work not inside L infinity, we now work just inside some Euclidean space, so one could use maybe Leon Simon and Michel result as well, but somehow Larry, because we really don't need honest minimal surfaces, so he did this Wenger's proof, which is just not long and could be as well done here. But why we are doing that? So when we reach the n minus one dimensional skeleton, so now we have kind of modified phi that maps this to some n minus one dimensional skeleton of our nerve, right? This will be exactly the map we are looking after. Remember, we are trying now, the second result, Larry, was the following. If volumes of all balls are small, Urson width is small. Right? So in order to prove that Urson width is small, we are supposed to present a map to some n minus dimensional complex and check why its diameters of all points, why inverse images of all points have small diameter. So, right. So that's what we are doing. And now, assume that we kind of corrected our map and we reached n minus one dimensional skeleton, where exactly the inverse images of points will be. Well, first of all, they all tend to come from the, if for example, we end up in some face of the nerve, the inverse images, so if we somehow hit some face of the nerve, then the inverse images will correspond points that coming there will be in the star of this face. And where this star, this face came from? Those faces all correspond to certain intersections of balls in our space. So if we find ourselves that two points come to the same face here, this means that they were in intersecting balls to begin with. And since the radius of those balls are very small, so for example, if our R in this theorem is one, if you are trying to ensure that the Urson width is at most one and all volumes of balls of radius one are small, then the radius of all those balls will be at most 1/100. So, and this shows this Urson width condition. So that's the structure of Larigus proof. But of course, I didn't tell you some of the most important things in this story. So, when we project, each time volume gets multiplied by L to the power d to the power n. It's not, of course, L to the power d, but L to the power d to the n. So essentially, when we care about our volumes remaining small, but what we get some kind of product, Ld times Ldn minus 1, etc., times Ln minus 1, and d minus 1. So how large is d? We don't know. We don't have any control over multiplicity of this overlap. So it means that we really would like to arrange matters so that this product converges. The infinite product from n minus 1 to infinity of those constants must be converging. This means that those constants Ld should be really, really close to 1. And this means that after improvements, our manifold should be really, really close to the boundary. And this means that its original volume should be really, really small. And what does it mean, small? So basically, the condition that is required in Larry's paper is this. So here there is a typo. So in this formula that I wrote, m is n. So replace two occurrences of m mentally by n. So this is kind of requirement. So we really would like to have a situation when we map, and x is m. So I'm kind of confusing the original proof and what I'm going to talk about. So we would like star of phi of mn, phi of mn intersection star of some phase to have volume that decreases exponentially with the dimension. Otherwise, it's not going to work. So one important thing on how one ensures it. Yeah, and here are not Ri, but R1. So here another type. It's supposed to be less than R1 to the power m, some constant exp, some constant minus constant dimension of the phase. So what does it mean? What does it mean, this exponential dependence on dimension of f? Among other things, it means the following. That we really would like to ensure the following. So assume that several balls of our covering intersect at some point. And they have radii R3, R2, R1 in decreasing order. And they intersect at some point. And we don't know how much will be the multiplicity of the intersection. But one thing that we need to require that the smallest radius, R1, must decrease exponentially with the multiplicity. It's not the whole story in Larry's paper, but it's the beginning of the story. So again, I am postponing telling you how one chooses those Ri. Maybe I will do it at the end of the talk if I will have time. Right, so if d good balls in the covering intersect, then the smallest radius behaves as exponentially as the function of the number of balls in the intersection. So here is a byproduct of Gould's construction of good balls. I would like somehow to mention that if B is a good ball of radius R and epsilon n is small, then the volume of this ball will be much smaller than R to the power n. In fact, Gould has some upper bound that looks like that. Some constant depending on m, epsilon m. Epsilon m is the bound on the volumes of ball of radius 1, r to the power m plus c, where r is the bound, is the radius of this ball. If this radius is comparatively large, it just tells that it's just some small constant. But we could assume that this is much less than 1 over 1,000 to the power m, and also r is small. So we see that the volumes of those balls, when they already are small, volumes are really small. Not just Euclidean small. Okay, now, so what we are going to do in order to prove this for HCM? So the answer is that, so basically the plan was to follow outline of two original Goose papers and look what needs to be changed. Now it turns out that more or less 90% of what's in those Goose papers don't work for HCM. So HCM has a lot of common features with Hausdorff measures. So for example, HCM is mono, so it has monotonicity. It has subadditivity. It has good behavior with respect to the Lipschitz map. If we have, if f is a Lipschitz, then Hausdorff HCM of f of a will be less than or equal than l to the power m HCM of a. Yet it doesn't have one very important property, no additivity for intersecting, for non-intersecting. For non-intersecting sets. So here are just a couple of dramatic examples of non-additivity. So assume, for example, that we are talking just a usual Euclidean disk, and we are looking at HC1. HC1 behaves roughly like a diameter. So it's easy to see that HC1 will be 1. Why? Because, for example, so here we are kind of summing ready. We are talking about sum coverings and summation of ready. But of course, those balls will need also to cover the diameter of this disk. And already for that, HC should be 1. So HC will be 1. Now assume that we are going to cut off half of this disk. So we are cutting something which has HC1, but yet HC of what remains didn't decrease at all. And moreover, if you will, for example, put here some tiny blobs, then HC could increase. Why I'm telling you all that? Because remember, one of the main part in this second part of the proof that involves Stefan Wenger's proof of Gromov's theorem was the idea that we were improving our manifold. We were cutting something, inserting something of smaller measure, cutting, inserting. Now it's kind of clear that it's not going to work at all, at least in this example. Even, for example, if we have something like HC2 and two-dimensional situation, here this number is equal to the dimension, so assume that we are talking about a disk with very large negative curvature. It has huge volume, but we can cover it by one ball of radius 1, and definitely we are happy with it, and definitely looks like the optimal way of doing it. If we will cut some small hole near that center, it seems intuitively clear that still there will be no better way to cover it than ball. So our main problem is struggle against absence of additivity. By the way, this absence of additivity is not only the problem in this Stefan Wenger part where we were improving our manifold. This proof of Larry Gu that I didn't tell you about, provides those exponential bounds. So if there are a lot of balls intersecting at a point, then they already must drop exponentially. Those exponential decrease bounds also use additivity at least in 4 different places. So now, how we are going to struggle against this non-additivity? So here is our first idea. Why this non-additivity arises in the first place? What is its mechanism? So the mechanism of this non-additivity, so let's explore the simplest possible thing. When we have 2 balls intersecting or not, maybe intersecting, of approximately comparable radii. So we would like to cover the union. Oh, sorry, the disjoint. Of course, I'm talking about disjoint. So here we have 2 disjoint balls of comparable radii, and I would like to cover them by some balls. And my concern is that when I look at the optimal covering, say of B2, it will intersect B1. So my main concern is the overlap between optimal from the point of view of Hausdorff content of coverings of my balls. So big balls are bad, small balls are good. I really would prefer a situation when I, for example, have a ball of radius r, and the optimal covering from the point of view of Hausdorff content has radius at most 1 r divided by 1,000. Then I'm in a good shape. So I might lose, because of the overlap, some kind of part of those balls, but I at least can be sure that the HC of the union will be greater than or equal than the sum of HCs of slightly smaller concentric balls. In order to do this, it's very helpful to ask that the Hausdorff content of Bi is less than Ri divided by some big constant to the power m. Why? Because it's kind of clear that it doesn't make sense to use the ball of radius Ri. We will, if this is so, then optimal covering will use only balls of the radius at most R1 over 1,000. And it greatly diminishes the potential for intersections. So it's clear that now the sum of m's powers of radii will be greater than HCM of union of slightly smaller concentric balls. Of course, that's not the whole of the story. Maybe the whole Hausdorff content will be near the boundary. But assuming that a significant part of the Hausdorff content will be inside, we will be in a good shape. Where from we are going to get those strange inequality, that HCM is less than R divided by 1,000? Remember, when I was talking about Stefan Wenger proof, that's exactly what the conditions that I imposed. Now, when I was talking about Larry's proof, remember, that was those good balls satisfy this condition and even more. We could make actually in his construction HC to be even much smaller than just R divided by any big constant to the power m. So there we seem to be kind of in a good shape. Still, somehow, there could be a bad situation when we have here small balls and here we have something big and we use some big ball for the covering of this big guy that will totally subsume our small ball. With all small balls, it will be kind of invisible from the point of view of Hausdorff content of the union, like in one of my examples. Still, there is a way of doing it. There is a certain strategy to ensure that those small balls are kind of indispensable for covering of all the big things that I'm not going to tell you about now. So here I have, beside this big problem, there are a lot of smaller problems. So essentially nothing works exactly as it works for measure expectedly. So here is an example of a theorem. It's just this K-R inequality that I mentioned at a certain point. So this K-R inequality basically tells us the following. So assume at least the version is required for us works like that. Assume that we have some Banach space and we have some set U that lives in a certain annulus. And we really would like to find a certain slice so that the intersection, spherical slice, so that the intersection of this sphere with U is small, right? And this K-R inequality tells us that we are able to do that. So here there is a proof for Hausdorff content. I'm not sure if I'm going to go through it. It's not very illuminating. In fact, it's even somewhat, it's close and somewhat easier than the proof of so-called Eilenberg inequality or K-R inequality for measures. So it works. And I have about something about 10 minutes. And maybe I could do the following. Since I told you so much about Larry Goose proofs and Gromov's proofs, maybe I'll just explain for the sake of completeness first how exactly Larry Goose chooses those balls. It's not a long story and rather beautiful. So basically how Larry chooses those good balls, that's the first thing I'm going to do. Let's assume that we have a manifold or metric space, doesn't matter, and we have some point P, and we really would like to find a good ball to be used in the covering via standard Vitali kind of argument. So what ball is good? Basically, the idea is the following. So let's start. So here, assume, for example, that our R is 1. We assume that all balls of radius 1 have a small volume, so our kind of main unit of distance is 1. So we are going to start from 0, 0, 1. Now for a ball of the chosen radius, we ask ourselves the following question. So let's compare the volume of a ball of radius 100 r, in this case unit ball, and the ball of radius 1/100 of r. So we really would like the volume of a bigger ball be controlled in terms of the volume of a smaller ball. So in the Euclidean case, this ball will be 10 to the power 4 times bigger, 10 to the power 4 n times bigger than the volume of this ball. However, we would like to give some slack. So we are kind of asking for a weak inequality. It's not just Euclidean, it's a little bit sub-Euclidean volume growth. We would like here, so here is a bigger ball, here is a smaller ball. We would like that the volume growth from smaller ball to a bigger ball to be a little bit less than the Euclidean growth. Now, if we have it for our R0, R0 is our guy, it's our good ball. If not, we take R1 equal to R0 divided by 10 thousandths. And we ask again our question, do we have, for this much smaller ball, R1, do we have this Euclidean volume growth? So if yes, R1 is our guy. If not, we're going down and down and down. And observe that because of this that the growth here is a little bit sub-Euclidean. So if we finish like at R0, R1, then kind of everything is fine. Kind of multiple intersections correspond to situations when we need to go down and down and down. And if we go down and down and down because of this extra, we kind of accumulate. We see that volumes of our balls are very far from being Euclidean. And this precisely gives the inequality that I mentioned, that if we really need to go many times, then the volume of our ball eventually will be less than or equal than some constant depending on n. Epsilon n is what we had at the beginning, times r to the power n plus c. Here we are getting something extra that's kind of helping in Larry's proof. Right, so maybe I'll just stop here. Thank you. No, last but not the least. So this being the last talk of the conference, I really would like to thank Fernanda for organizing this conference. It had been great to be here. Thank you.